In this video, we are going to cover another very important aspect of basic programming, that is methods. Basically, whenever you create any program, that program may be divided into sub-programs or sub-routines, which are called methods in programming life. So what are these methods all about? Basically, so far, whatever implementation you have done, we have a method called main, which actually got invoked or executed whenever your program starts executing. We can create some more methods in order to make our code even more clear and modular. So what you can do, you can give a particular name with a signature of a method. We will discuss what this signature is all about. So you can specify a method with a name. Inside that, you can pass some number of statements which combinedly will do some specific task. And whenever you will invoke this method with its name, all those set of statements will get executed. That simply means unless and until you will invoke a method, nothing will happen. You have to invoke a method in order to execute these statements, which whatever you have defined inside it. And whenever you want to process some data, you can always give and take some data to and from a method. Like if you want to process a couple of values, you can define the parameters or arguments inside a method signature. And once these input values are processed, your method can return the output as the return type. So that is what mentioned here. Input values can be given from parameters and arguments, and after the processing, when it wants to return the result, you can specify as a return type of that particular method. So far in the main, we have seen void, right? Void means this method is not going to return any value. You can use the return keyword only to terminate a particular method's execution, as we have seen earlier in the jump statement of control statements. Now, here you can use the return keyword to pass a value from the method body to wherever you are calling the methods. Alright, so in order to pass a value, you will use the parameters which will be having a data type, and to return the result, you will have to specify the return type, and then you can return that similar type value from the method. So method name along with the signature, means along with the return type and number of parameter and parameter types, will come create one method signature. By the time you are calling the method, you don't need to pass the return type, you just need to take the method name along with the values which you want to pass as a parameter. So rather than defining it here, let's do it practically now. So as earlier we discussed, like method is a set of statements which is executed whenever we invoke it. In this example, along with the main method, I have taken one more method named sample method, inside which I have passed a very simple statement in console.WriteLine. Now, obviously the execution will begin from the main method, and right here you can see like console.WriteLine program started, one message, then I will call this sample method, and then console.WriteLine program ended. So as soon as I will call this sample method, the control will come here and this message will be printed. But if I will not make a call to this particular method, obviously this line will never be printed. Program started, program ended. So that's why I said it will be executed whenever you will invoke it. So this is how you can invoke it, by just passing the name of the method along with the parentheses. And here what you can see, the execution, like program started, then a method call, it executed that particular statement, and then program ended. Let's see it how the flow will go on by pressing F11 now. So as you can see, execution begins with the main, console.WriteLine, program started, again F11, sample method. As soon as this call will be done, the control is now here in this sample method, which will execute this line, and then control will come back to this main. You saw I have made the call of sample method after main,
but main is still in the memory, but sample method is now unloaded. So whenever there is a method call, it is always in a stack format, that is last in, first out. Method which will be called at last will be first popped out from that stack. And after that, this main will continue, and as soon as this main is done, the program will be terminated as always. So this is how you can start putting up very basic programs using the method. But as you can see, like whenever I will call this method, it will do the particular task itself. But suppose I want to pass some values in this particular method to do the processings. So for that particular scenario, I will have to use the arguments or parameters. So right here you can see, like void add, in this I have passed two elements like x and y. So whenever you will make a call to this add method, you will have to pass two numbers, because if I will take the two numbers as a fix, this add will always evaluate those values. But obviously that will not make the best use of this method. So that's why I will pass the parameters which will change the value at every execution. So while defining a method, when you pass some elements right here, we call them formal arguments or parameters. Formal parameter means they don't contain the value, they are just defining the structure of a method. But while I'm invoking this, these parameters are having some value. So they are called the actual parameters or actual arguments. You can pass the variables as well as the constants like this. Alright, and when I will make the execution, I will get the different output as per the arguments. So whenever it is required to pass some values in the methods, you will have to use the parameters. But as you can see in this method, after doing the processing, when I got the result, I am only printing it. But maybe there could be a scenario where I want to reuse this value which I have evaluated from this method. Not in the same method, but probably in some other methods as well. So for that particular situation, I'll have to go for the return type. As so far you have seen, like I have used void as the return type, which means like it will not return anything. We will use void return type only when I'm sure like I'm done with everything. But when we are working with methods, there could be a scenario that you are just evaluating an intermediate value from a method, and later on possibly you can do some more operations with the same. So in that particular situation, I will change the return type to any particular type which type of value you are returning from the method, as something like this. As you can see, now I have used int because the result is of integer type, and as we have passed the integer, I am returning that sum which is again the integer type. We have already seen the return statement in the jump statements, where we use the return keyword for terminating a method. It will also terminate a method, so make sure whenever you are using a return statement, it must be the last statement of the method. And where it will return the value? Wherever you will make a call. Like in this particular statement, I am making a call, so the value will come back to this location. And as you can see, I am assigning that particular value in the another variable called result. After that, you can do whatever you want to do. Suppose if you have some other method, you can pass this value from main to that particular method. But here obviously I'm not doing anything, it's a very simple example, so I'm printing it here. But add method is not killing the scope of this sum value now, as it is returning which will enable this value to be reused in some other methods as well. Let's execute it. You will get the same output. There is no change. So this is how you can deal with the parameters and the return type of any method. Throughout this example, I'm using static keyword here just because I'm not interested in initializing the object of this particular class, as It is a part of object-oriented programming, which we will do later on. So don't focus on this static for now. Just put this static keyword before any method so that you don't have to create the instance or object of a particular class. I can make a direct call. It is nothing logical, just to avoid that initialization. Okay, now to understand this return type even in a clear way, here I have another example, a bit bigger one, where I have defined multiple methods like get grade, get percent, get total. In the discussion, as we stated, like creating the methods which will make your code even more modular. Now it's all your choice whether you want to get the total of the marks or the percentage or the grade. You can simply make the specific method call. As here I have called this get grade method. So first of all we will come to this get grade, and right here we have called get percentage, and in the get percentage I have called the get total. So again that call stack will be formed in which main is the first element and get total is the last element. So last in first out, and as per the rule this get total will be popped out from the stack first, because this method will take the input from the user, will do the total and will return it. As soon as it will return the value, it will be popped out from the stack. It will return this total in this particular line in the get percentage, which will calculate the percent. As soon as it will return the percent, this get percent method will be popped out, and then it will pass the value in the get grade function, where after getting the percentage we'll start comparing the percentage, and as per the percent we will return the grade, which will come here in the main method and will get printed. So let's execute this, and you see grade C. Alright, let me re-execute this by putting some separator to get a clear output. Alright, now it's fine. 78, 79, 93, grade A. So this is how you can make the chaining of method calls like this.
Now, as we have already done with the basic implementations of methods, now let's see what are the different ways to call a particular method. As here on the screen you can see, like we can call it by value, call by reference, call by output, and call by params are the ways through which you can invoke a particular method. So now let's have a practical of these things as well.
First of all, let's have a look in the call by value. As here you can see, it's a very default way to call a particular method. So whenever you will pass the actual parameter, it will get copied in the formal parameter and it will create a very separate copy. So if any changes will be there in formal parameter, will not be reflected in the actual parameter, because both are having their separate memory spaces. So as in this example, as you can see, I have assigned a value 10 in this A, I have printed that, and then I pass the same A to the X. So X also got 10 initially, but later I changed it from 10 to 100. So finally X will become 100, but it will not cause any changes in the actual parameter, that is A, and it will remain 10 as you can see now in the output. Final value of formal parameter is 100, but the final value for actual parameter is still 10. But if I will add the ref keyword in both the places, it will become call by reference. That simply means that this integer X is not taking a different memory space now, rather it will be referring the value of A. So the value is stored only at a single position, and if you will make the changes in any of it, the same area will be affected. Now A is assigned to 10, initial value of actual parameter will be 10. I pass the reference of A to X, so even though I will make the changes in X, the A will be affected. As you can see now in the output, when you print the final value of actual parameter, it is also 100. So this is how call by value and call by reference works. Similarly, if you want to pass the value from the method body to the calling environment, you can use call by out. You can pass as many as out parameters as you want. If you want to pass multiple values from this method to this calling environment, because return statement will only pass a single value only, but you can pass multiple out parameters. So whenever you will work with this out parameter, this formal parameter will never accept a value from the actual parameter. As you can see, A is initialized with 10 and I am passing it here A, but this is not taking the value and saying use of unassigned out parameter X. That simply means that X has not taken the value from A, that is actual parameter. So it is fine even if you will not initialize this A, because it is not going to give any value. Rather, here this actual parameter is waiting to get a value, not to pass a value. So let's comment this line because it is giving me an error, and let's comment the value as well. I'll have to comment this line because it is uninitialized and I'm not able to print this. So let's comment this one as well. And now you see I have passed the uninitialized value right here, but as soon as X will be getting a value, it will assign it to A as well. So both are now 100. So this is how call by out works. Now let's have a look on call by params, where you can use a params integer array which must be the last argument of the method, and you can pass as many as elements you want. As you can see, this is an array type, but if you will not pass this params keyword, it will be mandatory to pass the integer array right here. But in call by params, it's all your wish. Two parameters are required to be passed, but after that you can pass 3, 4, 5 or even not any particular value for this params. So let's see how it works like. So in this console.writeline, I'll directly call it so that it will be printed also. So two values are for sure. After that, whatever you will pass will go to this params list. So 30, 40, 50, and let's execute it. It is now 150. If I'll call it again, so you see I'm not passing any value to that, but still it is working. So this is all about the call by params. When some method is having a number of parameters, we have discussed, like, even for calling that particular method, we have to pass all the parameters in the very same sequence. But in order to make your code even more clear, you can use the named parameters like this. As here you can see, in this rectangle area, I have taken a couple of arguments like float height and float width. And you see, whenever I'm calling this particular method, width colon, this is the named parameter. And now you can change the sequence as well, because you are putting the name on which you want to assign a value. So like width is second parameter, but I'm calling it first. So width is 12, height is 10.5, and it will do the things like this. So you can use this named parameter as well. And if you will initialize the value at the time you are defining it, it will make this argument optional. As you can see, now I am not passing any value to this width because I have already initialized it. If you will not pass any value, it will continue with this default value itself. But make sure the optional parameter must be at the last of all the mandatory parameters. So if I will execute it now, it will automatically take the width as 10 and will give the result accordingly. But if you want, you can obviously pass the width as well. Like here I say width 20, and now it will execute accordingly. So this is how you can work with the methods in C#.